Welcome to CityWorks, a program that looks at issues faced by working people in today's urban society. CityWorks is a production of the School of Labor and Urban Studies at the City University of New York and CUNY TV. I'm Laura Flanders. In January, a public forum was held that examined these critical days following the election of President Joe Biden, titled The First 100 Days, Policy Priorities for Labor and Social Justice Movements. It was produced by the School of Labor and Urban Studies. The forum was so highly relevant and well-received that we have decided here at CityWorks to start this program with selections from that discussion. Two of the panelists from the forum are here with me for this taping. Dorian Warren, president of Community Change, one of the nation's most outstanding social justice organizations, and Felicia Wong. She's president and CEO of the Roosevelt Institute, a progressive think tank renowned for its commitment to economic justice. Felicia also served, we might add, on the Biden-Harris transition team. You'll see both of them back here with me after these excerpts from our first 100 days forum.
I was struck in the second term of Obama, I listened to Reverend Jesse Jackson give a charge to organizers roughly around 2013, 2014. And he had this great rap. He said, you know, Lincoln was a good president, but he became a great president because of the abolitionist movement. FDR was a good president, but he became a great president because of the labor movement. LBJ was a good president, but he became a great one because of the Black Freedom Movement and poor people's movements. Obama was a good president. And the stuff that got won was by movement pressure. If you think of the disruption by queer activists around marriage equality or immigrant rights activists, the stuff that got won was by movements. So the question for us then is, what kind of president do we want to make Biden? Do we just want a good restorative president to go back to some mythical normal that didn't work out for most of us? Or do we want a great transformative president? And I say that to say that we have agency here. We have agency here. It's an all hands on deck moment for everybody listening or watching.
They're not going to do what we don't push them to do. And they may not do all the things that we want them to do, right? And so this is why movement is always important. Like, just because, you know, Biden is there, Harris is there, doesn't mean that we should stop organizing, protesting, and voting, right? Like, those things have to continue to happen. There's going to be a lot of compromises that are going to be made that are political compromises. But I also think, and right, like, so from my perspective, it's like, you better listen to the movement and like who put you in office. But you know what? There were a lot of people that still voted for that other guy, right? And so like America is like, kind of split almost down the damn middle. And so I think that what that means is that there's going to be a lot of middle of the road work that people in Congress are going to move. And that's because they know 4 years is not a long time. Some of them will be on a 2-year clock, right? Because they'll be up for election. And so I am worried about that, but I also think that's why movement has to be continuing to push, continuing to call for the radical things. You know, we're gonna have new voices like a Cori Bush out of St. Louis, who is just like incredible, right? And so you have to have the left flank. The left flank brings the right, even not, I don't mean the right, but like the left, right, out towards the left. And so I think that that's going to be quite important.
And, you know, I've been listening to plenty of like sort of hard boiled, you know, Hill reporters or White House reporters who are even mentioning, gosh, this is the first time that we have heard the White House economic team, you know, care more about the labor markets than the financial markets. Like, there's something new and something different going on here.
Our economic system has dramatically failed to meet the needs of workers. The unemployed, the employed, the underemployed. And so the Biden administration needs to promote very, very bold action, not tinker at the edges. It's got to be fundamental to make the interests of workers and their and unions a central part of its program. It can't treat unions as just another special interest group. President Biden could use the government's buying power to require that all contractors, if they want to do business with the federal government, pay a minimum $15 wage, paid sick leave, comply with health and safety laws, demand employer neutrality when the employees of these subcontractors seek to unionize, use government buying power to create more higher paid green jobs.
I am still kind of encouraged by the fact that Joe Biden, as a human being, is totally upfront about his support for unions. So that's on the one hand. On the other hand, the fight either for or against unions isn't just about what one person, even a person as powerful as the president of the United States, thinks about unions. I mean, it's very clear that the conservative movement has made shrinking unions, increasing the right to work right to work laws in various states. They see that as a political project, specifically because unions are a political force that they see as threatening to both their economic agenda and also, frankly, their electoral ability to stay in power.
It's not an accident that the Biden-Harris administration is supportive of a $15 an hour minimum wage. When in 2012, when the fight for 15 in the union was launched, it was laughed out the room by a whole bunch of progressive liberal folks. And here we are, right? Even the former President Obama could only get to 9 or 10. So we're in a different moment. And it is the result of movement pressure, of grassroots organizing. You don't understand a Michigan or a Wisconsin or an Arizona or a Georgia without understanding the grassroots organizing that took years to build up the power.
I think inequality now is so bad, actually, in the quote K-shaped recovery or the K-shaped non-recovery for the people who are at the bottom part of the K. I think it's so bad that we actually can't even conceptualize it.
Yeah.
Especially for those of us who, are fortunate enough to still have our jobs and to work from home and to be now, Zoom fluent or whatever. I think we do not even, because we don't, we don't go a lot of places anymore. We cannot even see or understand just how bad it is for people who are, let's say, in the bottom 40% of the income distribution. It is we don't even know it. And I think that's a really important thing for our politics.
Restructuring the economy is absolutely critical. I couldn't agree more. I mean, we have, the greatest wealth disparity ever. We have CEOs making 320 times more than your median worker. And the workers who are most negatively impacted by wealth inequality in this country are workers of color. And we've been seeing them dying in this virus where they've been on the front line, making, wages that are barely livable or not livable at all.
I think we really need to focus on jobs, on job creation. Obviously, those jobs need to be union jobs. But I am very cognizant of the fact that we are 10 million jobs short, given where we have 10 million fewer employed people now than we did in February of 2020, purely as a result of COVID. And then we have 5 million people who don't even show up in those numbers because they'd stopped looking for work. So that's 15 million people. Call it 50 million people if you think about, their families and other people that they support. But that's 15 million jobs, and that's, 40, 50 million people who are suffering because they have no income. And and therefore no hope, no political hope, et cetera.
In this moment, are we a multiracial democracy or not? And you know what? Multiracial democracy, as we've lived through and many people have not survived it, it is really effing hard, right? It has really never successfully happened in the history of human civilization. So in that context, right, this experiment here where we find ourselves, this thing called the United States of America, this is a long struggle to create something, to invent something that has never succeeded in human history.
I would love to see a multiracial, green, 15 million jobs campaign. I think a lot of people could get behind that. I think it would do great things for our economy. I think it would do great things for the labor movement. And I think it would do great things for our politics.
Dorian Warren is the president of the Center for Community Change and a passionate voice for working people. Felicia Wong heads up the Roosevelt Institute. Under her leadership, the Institute has grown fourfold. She also served on the Biden-Harris transition team. Felicia, let me start with you. In our forum, you sound very hopeful about a green jobs plan and about Joe Biden. Do you still feel hopeful? Still feel confident we'll see the kind of change you're looking for?
Laura, first of all, thank you for having me. I think now's a time that we really have to practice hope. And thankfully, the Biden team is making that easier than I would have even expected a few months ago. They really have put out a set of policies that meets our political moment. And I think they understand how to tie together our economic crises, our racial crises, and our climate crises into kind of a vision that could, if movements really get connected to that, that could really inspire a lot of Americans. I don't think the administration is going to do it alone, but I do think that the administration and regular people, people in movements together, can make an enormous difference in this country.
Well, she's singing your song, clearly, Dorian. But I'm going to ask you the question that we all love, which is, what would you do if you were president? I mean, you talked about the importance of narrative, of telling a story, and that speaks to vision. What would be the vision-infused story that you would tell right now if you were Joe?
Well, there's two things, Lauren. First of all, it's great to be back with you after many, many years.
Always a pleasure.
So there's the story and narrative. And then the question was, what would I do if I were president? So I want to come back to that. But the story I would tell is really simple, and it draws on our own political traditions, particularly progressive political traditions. I would say that this moment is a combination of Reconstruction, the beginning of Reconstruction in the 1860s, meets the New Deal. Mm-hmm. Because those are two moments, right? One was about really taking on white supremacy and advancing racial justice and Black freedom, as well as, frankly, empowering former people who were property, right? So there is a worker power element there. And then you fast forward to the New Deal after the greatest economic crisis of to date, right, in the early 30s, that just set the table for our entire 20th century of social programs, of worker power, of shared prosperity. So I think of this moment, and that's a story I would tell. Reconstruction meets the New Deal. Now, you said, what would I do if I were president? I would be inviting movement activists in all the time, telling them the same line that FDR said to A. Philip Randolph, go out and make me do it. Yeah. That's what I would do. None of this is rocket science.
All right, so I love you, and I love being reminded of moments in history, but I also remember how both of those moments turned out.
Yes.
And Felicia pointed out, well, I think many people have pointed out in our forum, that there is a lot of the country that still voted for Donald Trump. Reconstruction ended up with a right-wing resurgence of white supremacy of a very deadly sort. And the New Deal set a table that left an awful lot of people out. Women,
right.
People of color, farm workers, domestic workers. So I hear from people all the time, we need to get beyond all of that and do something really very new. Dorian.
Well, I would just say on the failures of this is the role of history, to learn from our failures and mistakes and not to necessarily be trapped by history. So yes, why did Reconstruction fail? Because of the lack of accountability for the traitors and the seditionists and the insurrectionists of that time, the Confederates. And so we do need an accountability moment in this moment to say, we are not appeasing traitors and seditionists and white supremacists, number one. To your point about the New Deal, and Felicia and I together, and the Roosevelt Institute in particular, we've written a lot about this. How do we learn the lessons about the exclusions, and especially the racial and gender exclusions that were baked into the New Deal? There's been a flurry of scholarship, right? So it's at this point, we know better. So how do we then construct, if you think of, Reverend Barber likes to say a third Reconstruction, but if you think of this moment as a third Reconstruction and a second New Deal, then how do we learn the lessons of the failures while also crafting something that meets our moments and the conditions that we're facing today?
So Felicia, in terms of these meetings, we are hearing all sorts of movement groups are more at the table than they have been in past administrations, including the Obama administration. We also are seeing, even at the state level here in New York, Senator Schumer, powerful senator, clearly worried about a threat from you-know-who, AOC, meeting with all sorts of progressives from the Working Families Party, from the guests that we had on the show just last episode around housing rights. How real is that? How veneer and how much heat do they actually feel in this administration from the left? And obviously a question for union people, how do we turn up that heat?
I think, again, the answer to that question isn't how real is it, but how real are we going to make it? A number of us, Dorian and I, have met with, administration leaders, have met with Senator Schumer. And I do think that all of them are pushed certainly by the politics, they're politicians, but they're also pushed by a very real change in how all of us think about both the economy and racial justice. There is no question that they understand that what had been happening before, this kind of let the market do what it wants, and then like government maybe can tweak around the edges to fix a few mistakes, kind of after post-tax and transfer, as the economists like to say, that approach, that tweaking around the edges approach, did not work. And I think that a number of mainstream politicians, including President Biden, including Senator Schumer, really kind of get that. They see the data and they're appointing economic leaders, Janet Yellen, Heather Boucher, Jared Bernstein, who are really saying the same things. Now, again, this isn't going to happen by itself. It's really important that Biden listen to people like Dorian and that Dorian goes out there and makes Biden do it. But I do think that's possible. And the other thing I would say is that it's important to remember that the federal government has a tremendous amount of power. That power can and should be used for people of color and not against us. It's not just that race policy or economic policy, frankly, is kind of over here in the corner and it's just about criminal justice or it's just about housing. Every single policy decision that this administration will make will have racialized effects. The only question is, will it have positive racial effects? And I think it can be if we think about it as such and if we push the administration to think about it in just that way.
Dora, did I miss memo? Are you moving to Washington? I can see all the books have disappeared off your shelf.
I left New York and I live in Washington right now and I'm moving very, very soon. But those books that are now packed in my boxes do remind me of all the lessons learned that Felicia just pointed out around the role of movement politics, of the inside-outside game, of not being confused by access to power with what is righteous and what is right and what will actually solve the biggest problems of our generation. Mm.
So how do people do it? Especially how do trade unions do it? I mean, by all accounts, trade unions, the UAW, others are at the table, their economic memos, some of them was apparently that are guiding the administration. But we have been in similar places to this before. We've heard, listen, we were there with you, but there are all these millions of people that voted for Trump. It's 50-50 in the Senate. It's tight even in the House, really. Back off. Don't scare the horses. What's your advice? What have we really learned about how to battle with our ostensible friends, Dorian?
Oh, well, I think this is the time for boldness and to be unapologetic about advancing a bold vision for social, economic, racial, and gender justice. And so there are a couple of things in terms of worker power and the labor movement. One is, yes, there is federal legislation, the PRO Act, that would be game-changing and set some new conditions that make it easier for workers to join together, to unionize, or to, frankly, for those that are already in unions, to have more collective bargaining power in this moment of extreme inequality. That's at the federal level. Let's be very clear, that is not the magic bullet by itself. So for unions, and I actually have been talking to the UAW, who are doing amazing work right now in terms of trying to think about the industry in every single region of this country, not just in Michigan and Ohio, where traditionally the big three have been. But what is, for the labor movement, is this a 1930s moment or not? Is this a 1930s moment for the mass organizing of workers, whether at a company or independent contractors who are misclassified? What does this moment mean for the strategies of unions in places around the country to organize on a massive scale to rebuild the labor movement and to really save our democracy? Because you cannot have a democracy without a strong labor movement.
Mm, mm. We've talked about race a lot. I just want to talk for a moment about gender. There are two things that currently in play, it seems to me, that I just wanted to lift up. And Felicia, I'd love both you and Dorian to speak to this, but I'll start with you. One is this paid family leave and subsidized childcare part of the stimulus package. Are we going to get it? And then the other one is the end to the tipped wage, which disproportionately affects women of color, work in service industries like restaurants, shouldn't be dependent on a tipped wage that has stayed the same since, I think, 1973 or something horrible like that, $2 plus. What is the likelihood that will be a kind of bargaining chip left on the table? And how can people at home, maybe not in the streets, but at home, maybe union members, what can they do if they want to push that back into a place of possible passage?
Right, all of that, paid family leave, childcare subsidies, including the childcare tax credit, ending the tipped wage, all of these things are absolutely essential to make sure that the kind of women's dropping out of the labor market that we've seen over the past 6 months, 9 months, to make sure that that is to some degree reversed, because we've really seen a terrible backsliding around women in the labor market as a result of the pandemic and as a result of the fact that we don't have these kinds of policies that help women keep their jobs and make sure their jobs are good. I will say that it is absolutely important that we think about all of these things as of a piece in a kind of not just a new economics, but a really a new women's economics and a new women's labor economics. You know, I do have a lot of confidence that Janet Yellen, for example, understands that. The question is really a legislative strategy question and, you know, what people are going to really push for. I have some hope, but it's kind of hard from where we sit to know what really is going to happen.
Yeah. Dorian, I'd love any response from you. And then I'd love you to end with what unions have meant to you in your family, in your life. Why'd you care so much?
Well, I would say, just to piggyback on what Felicia just said, especially around the care economy, is one of the, it is our future in this country. And by the way, you can't ship those jobs away. So whether it's early learning and childcare, whether it is paid family leave, that is vital. We are one of the only rich democracies that does not offer paid family leave, whether it's long-term care for our elders who need the care. Those are all the millions of jobs that are possible from that throughout the lifespan. We need care work. And so it is a gender justice issue. It is a racial justice issue. It's an economic justice issue. And is also a place to build worker power for the long-term, because that is the future of our economy. So it's a win-win, particularly for the labor movement. What do unions mean to me? I mean, it's, as you probably know, Laura, it's very personal for me. My three of my four grandparents in Chicago, who migrated from the Jim Crow authoritarian South up to Chicago, were janitors. They joined the janitors union, SEIU Local 1, very early on in the founding of that union. My mother was a 40-year member of the Chicago Teachers Union, which is showing the way nationally for how to exercise worker power and, as they say, bargain for the common good in terms of not just children, but also parents and teachers in that city. They are a model for the rest of the country. So this has always been personal for me. And, you know, as a former union organizer, as a former union member, as someone who has studied this for a long time, as I said earlier on, no labor movement, no democracy, no labor movement, no middle class. And that is the choice point we are at in this moment, if we're going to have a strong labor movement or not, because the fate of our democracy is at stake.
Top that, Felicia. Final comment.
Well, I absolutely agree with Dorian on the importance of labor unions and the and movements generally, but especially labor unions. I'm really proud that the Roosevelt Institute, obviously FDR, Wagner Act, labor movement, but also that Roosevelt itself is a unionized workplace. This is something that actually, I think, makes communication in our workforce a lot better. And I am extremely glad that that's the kind of workplace we run. Now, the last thing I'll say though, with respect to sort of why it's personal, I think it's personal for a lot, for all of us, because of where we came from. Mm-hmm. You know, my grandparents were immigrants from Southern China in the 1930s. My parents grew up literally one in the back of a grocery store, kind of doing his homework at the back table. The other, my mom grew up, you know, the back of a restaurant doing her homework at the back table while she was like putting the silverware away. I think it's important to remember that working people and working immigrants are the backbone of not only our movement, but of this country. And so that is why I do everything I can to make sure that we have a future where that backbone continues to be strong.
Well, I want to thank our very special guests, Dorian Warren, Felicia Wong. Thank you so much. If you out there in the audience have questions, comments, you can write to us at CityWorks. That's cityworks@slu.cuny.edu. For CityWorks, I'm Laura Flanders.